Clinical examination of an abdominal lump. For inspection, let the patient lie down supine, relaxed with the legs semi-flexed. Expose the abdomen from the level of the nipples to the groins. First, note the contour of the abdomen. Is it scaphoid, normal or distended? To inspect the contour, imagine a line from the tip of the xiphoid process to the pubic symphysis as demonstrated by this ruler. If the abdomen is concave and lies below this line, it is termed as scaphoid. If it is more or less along this plane, it is flat or normal. And if it is above this plane and convex, it is termed as distended or protuberant. If the abdomen is distended, note whether the distension is uniform or is it more in one area or to one side. For this, compare the symmetrical areas on both sides of the midline for fullness. Inspect the lateral borders of the flanks, whether they are distended or concave. Note the distended right flank compared to the normal left flank, which is concave. And later, in sitting position, we will inspect the renal angles for fullness. Note the renal angle fullness on the right side in this case of a right renal lump. Now inspect the skin over the abdomen for redness, scars, striae, branding marks, nodules and dilated veins. Redness over a lump suggests local inflammation. Redness of skin around the umbilicus in an acute abdomen suggests acute hemorrhagic pancreatitis, termed as the Cullen sign. Branding marks usually suggest presence of chronic or long-standing pain. Hard subcutaneous nodules, as seen in this case of carcinoma of stomach, indicate secondary spread of the malignancy to the skin. Dilated veins around the umbilicus with centrifugal flow suggest portal hypertension with caput medusae, while vertical femoroaxillary veins are seen in vena cava obstruction. If there is a scar of previous operation, ask the details about the nature of the previous operation. The scar itself will tell us many things. For example, this scar at the McBurney's point is of appendicectomy. This scar under the right costal margin is of cholecystectomy. This scar is of suprapubic systolithotomy or prostatectomy. This scar is of a kidney operation. Now note the widening of this scar in the central part. A ragged wide scar suggests wound infection after the previous operation. After inspecting the skin, inspect the umbilicus. Is the umbilicus in the center? Normally, it is in the midline, midway between the tip of the xiphoid process and the top of the symphysis pubis. It is displaced upwards by the lumps arising from the pelvis. Note here that the distance between the xiphoid process and the umbilicus is less than the distance between the umbilicus and symphysis pubis. In ascites, reverse is the case. The distance between the xiphoid process and the umbilicus is more than the distance between the umbilicus and symphysis pubis. This is Tanyol's sign. Then note the shape of the umbilicus. In ascites, it may be transversely stretched, or a laughing umbilicus, or everted as an umbilical hernia. Then ask the patient to cough and look for an expansile impulse indicating an umbilical or para-umbilical hernia. Now inspect the abdomen tangentially from the side and from the leg end for the movement of the abdominal wall during respiration and for visible peristalsis and visible pulsations. Note the abdominal wall movement during respiration and compare it with the chest expansion. If thoracic movements are more prominent, it is thoracoabdominal breathing, common in males. If abdominal movements are more prominent, it is termed as abdominothoracic type of breathing, more common in females. In peritonitis, as seen in this case, the abdomen does not move during respiration. Note that only the chest expands. In localized peritonitis, only the affected portion of the abdomen may be immobile. If there is a visible lump, particularly if it is in the upper abdomen, observe carefully whether it moves up and down with each respiration. Note the movement of this lump with respiration. Now this is a liver with multiple nodules. Note the movement with respiration. The lumps connected to the diaphragm, that is from liver, gallbladder, spleen and stomach, move very well with respiration. Renal lumps move slightly, while retroperitoneal lumps and intra-abdominal lumps not connected to the diaphragm do not move with respiration. Then look for visible peristalsis. Note this peristaltic wave in the epigastrium moving from left to right. This is a characteristic sign of pyloric stenosis. These are visible peristalsis in the distended coils of small intestine in intestinal obstruction. And this is a stepladder pattern of peristalsis showing multiple distended loops rising towards the center, typical of low ileal obstruction. Lastly, look for visible pulsations. Aneurysm of abdominal aorta, as seen in this patient, is pulsatile. If a lump is in the epigastrium or umbilical region, that is overlying the abdominal aorta, it may show transmitted pulsations from the abdominal aorta. The lump itself is not pulsatile. These pulsations will disappear in the knee elbow position when the lump falls away from the aorta. You should also keep in mind that in a very thin patient, even the pulsations of the abdominal aorta may be visible. Having completed the inspection of the abdomen proper, ask the patient to stand and inspect the scrotum for a testicular swelling. Note the epigastric lump due to secondaries in the paraaortic lymph nodes arising from a right testicular tumor. Then inspect the hernial orifices. Ask the patient to cough and look for a cough impulse. If the lump is arising from the pelvis or is very large, inspect the legs for edema. Then ask the patient to sit and, standing behind the patient, inspect the spine for any deformity, gibbous, kyphus, kyphosis or scoliosis. Inspect the paraspinal area for any paraspinal swelling or sinus. Paraspinal sinus or scar is very suggestive of tuberculosis of spine. Then inspect the renal angles for fullness. Note the fullness of renal angle on the right side in this case of a right renal lump. Lastly, inspect the left supraclavicular region for a swelling due to enlarged lymph nodes. Left supraclavicular lymph nodes can be enlarged due to secondary deposits from the malignancy of stomach, colon or testis, termed as the Troisier sign. And the enlarged left supraclavicular lymph nodes are termed as the Firkhaus nodes. This completes the inspection. Remember to inspect the four sides out of the abdomen: scrotum, hernial orifices, spine and the left supraclavicular lymph nodes. To revise, on inspection, note the contour of the abdomen, whether scaphoid, normal or distended. Look for a localized bulge, and if localized bulge is seen, note the effect of raising the neck. Inspect the skin for redness, scars, striae, branding marks and dilated veins. Inspect the umbilicus for position, transverse stretching or eversion. Observe the movements of the abdominal wall and movements of the lump with respiration. Look for visible peristalsis and visible pulsations in the lump. Ask the patient to stand and inspect the hernial orifices and the scrotum. From the back side, inspect the spine, paraspinal regions and the renal angles. And lastly, inspect the left supraclavicular region for swelling. Now let us proceed to palpation. For palpation, the patient should lie comfortably and relaxed on the examination couch with a pillow under the head and legs semi-flexed, preferably with a pillow under the knees to relax the abdominal wall muscles. Ask the patient to take deep breath through open mouth. If your hands are cold, especially in the cold weather or after washing the hands with cold water. Warm them by rubbing against each other before commencing palpation. First, note the temperature over the site of the abdominal lump, comparing it with normal, and note if there is any local rise of temperature suggestive of acute inflammation in the lump. Then palpate gently with a flat hand all over the abdomen to feel the tone of the abdominal wall muscles and tenderness. Normally, the abdomen feels soft and elastic and is non-tender. If there is tenderness, that is pain on palpation, demarcate the exact area or point of tenderness. For example, this patient has localized tenderness over McBurney's point, suggestive of acute appendicitis. Then note the presence of guarding and rigidity. If, as you press over the abdomen, the wall muscles contract and the wall becomes firm and non-elastic, the reflex phenomenon is termed as guarding. Note the soft abdomen on the left side and the reflex muscle contractions or guarding on the right side. If the muscles are in a state of sustained contraction, even when you are not palpating, it is termed as rigidity. Note the board-like rigidity all over the abdomen in this patient with acute peritonitis. If guarding is detected, keep the hand over the site with gentle pressure and divert the patient's attention to some conversation. Observe whether the guarding disappears. Voluntary guarding, which is due to patient's oversensitivity or fear, will disappear if you successfully divert the patient's attention away from the act of palpation. If there is mild localized tenderness, look for rebound tenderness. Palpate the tender area with a flat hand and slowly press down the hand, pressing deeper with each expiration. Now withdraw the hand suddenly. If the patient gets acute pain on withdrawal of the hand, it is termed as rebound tenderness. It indicates inflammation of the parietal peritoneum due to underlying inflamed organ. Note the acute pain on withdrawal of the palpating hand. In presence of intestinal obstruction, rebound tenderness suggests strangulation. Now let us proceed to deep palpation. This includes a detailed palpation of the lump first and then palpation of the rest of the abdomen. Palpation of the lump. Before proceeding to the detailed palpation of the lump, first you must determine whether the lump is intra-abdominal or extra-abdominal. For this, first feel the swelling, keep your hand at the lower border of the swelling and ask the patient to take deep breaths. If the swelling moves with respiration, it is definitely intra-abdominal. If it does not move, it may be either parietal or intra-abdominal. Then ask the patient to raise the neck, making the abdominal muscles taut. If on raising the neck, the swelling becomes difficult to feel and less prominent, then it is intra-abdominal. If it becomes more prominent and easier to palpate, check whether it can be moved side to side. If it is mobile, as seen in this swelling over the right hypochondrium, then it is subcutaneous, superficial to the muscle. And if it becomes fixed on contracting the wall muscles, as seen in this patient, then it is within the muscle or intramuscular. If the lump is situated laterally, the muscles are made taut either by asking the patient to raise the legs to 30 degrees without bending the knees or by Valsalva's maneuver. Now proceed to palpate the lump in details. First, identify the borders of the lump. Measure its size in centimeters using a measuring tape. Then note its location in relation to the quadrant involved and in relation to the costal margin, umbilicus, anterior superior iliac spine or symphysis pubis. Then note its shape, surface and margin. A well-defined margin suggests neoplasm, while an ill-defined margin is a feature of an inflammatory swelling. Then note the consistency of the swelling. whether it is soft, cystic, firm or hard. The consistency may be uniform throughout the swelling or it may be variable, that is different in different parts of the swelling. If the swelling is cystic, test for fluctuation and fluid thrill. If the swelling is in the lumbar region, palpate bimanually to feel the exact size and consistency by feeling it between the two hands. If the swelling is in the right or left hypochondrium, check whether it extends under the costal margins and whether the fingers can be insinuated between it and the costal margin. Note how fingers can be insinuated between the right costal margin and a right renal lump. Now test the mobility of the swelling. If the swelling is in the upper half of the abdomen, check the movement with respiration, which we have already studied. Then hold the swelling between the fingers of both hands and try to move it vertically and horizontally. If it is mobile, look for restriction of movement in any direction. For example, a mesenteric cyst is freely mobile at right angles to the attachment of mesentery, but less mobile in the line of attachment of mesentery. While an ovarian cyst is mobile in all directions, vertical as well as horizontal. If the swelling is in the flanks, palpate it bimanually and test for anteroposterior mobility and ballotability. Keep the right hand over the anterior abdominal wall in the lumbar region and place the left hand in the loin with the tips of the fingers reaching the renal angle. Now palpate with both hands simultaneously and try to move the swelling anteroposteriorly. If it is mobile and not touching the anterior abdominal wall, test for ballotability. Keep the anterior hand very gently over the lumbar region and give a sudden forward push to the swelling with the posterior hand. If the mass touches the anterior hand and falls back, it is termed as ballotable. Only renal lumps are ballotable. Lastly, test whether the lump is pulsatile. If the lump is pulsatile, place two index fingers over two sides of the swelling as far apart as possible and note the pulsations. Note that in this case, the fingers move up and away from each other. That is, this is an expansile pulsation diagnostic of aneurysm of aorta. While in the second case, the fingers move only upwards. This is a transmitted pulsation due to the swelling lying over the aorta. If in doubt, place the patient in knee-elbow position and then feel for the pulsations. Transmitted pulsations will disappear as the swelling will fall away from the aorta, but an aneurysm will continue to pulsate. Note the pulsations felt in knee-elbow position in this case of aneurysm of abdominal aorta. Now we proceed to palpate the rest of the abdomen. Palpate for enlarged liver, spleen and kidneys. And if any of them are palpable or are located close to the lump, note their relation to the lump. To palpate for the liver, start palpating in the right iliac fossa along the midclavicular line with the fingers parallel to the liver border, exerting moderate pressure during expiration. Wait to feel the lower border as it descends during deep inspiration. If it is not felt, move the hand up by 1 cm and palpate again till you reach and feel the liver border, or you reach the right costal margin and liver is not palpable. If liver is palpable, note its size, border, surface, consistency and tenderness. Then palpate for the spleen from the right iliac fossa towards the left costal margin with fingers parallel to the left costal margin. If spleen is palpable, note its size in centimeters from the left costal margin. Then palpate the anterior border for splenic notch and note that the fingers cannot be insinuated under the costal margin. If spleen is not palpable, then turn the patient to his right side, place the left hand firmly over the left lower chest, Dip the right hand under the right costal margin and ask the patient to take a deep breath. A just palpable spleen hiding under the costal margin will be felt by this method. Then palpate bimanually in both lumbar regions for renal lump. If the abdomen is very thin, lower pole of the right kidney may normally be palpable. Next, palpate the rest of the abdomen for any abnormality. Look for colonic tenderness in the flanks and intercostal tenderness over the lower chest on both sides. Then palpate the scrotum, looking for testicular tumor. Test for presence of testicular sensations. Note the right testicular swelling in a patient who presented for an epigastric lump. Make the patient stand and palpate over the hernial orifices and ask the patient to cough, feeling for a cough impulse and hernial swelling. If the lump is arising from the pelvis or from the retroperitoneal space or is so large as to compress the inferior vena cava, then examine the legs for edema due to compression of the veins or obstruction to the lymphatics. Then examine the back. Palpate the spine for deformity and tenderness. Look for renal angle tenderness. And lastly, palpate the supraclavicular fossa from behind, particularly on the left side, for Virchow's lymph nodes. To revise, on palpation, first conduct superficial palpation to detect warmth and tenderness. If there is tenderness, mark the exact area or spot of tenderness and look for guarding, rigidity or rebound tenderness. Then conduct deep palpation. First palpate the lump and then the rest of the abdomen. On palpating the lump, first determine whether the lump is intra-abdominal or extra-abdominal. Then note the size, shape, consistency and the exact location of the lump. If it is in the lumbar region, do bimanual palpation and test ballotment. And lastly, test for mobility and pulsatility. Then palpating the rest of the abdomen, palpate for the liver, spleen and the kidneys. Note the relation of the lump to these organs. Look for tenderness over the colon, lower intercostal spaces and the renal angles. Lastly, palpate the scrotum, the hernial orifices, the back and the left supraclavicular nodes. Now let us proceed to percussion. First, percuss over the lump. Solid swelling will give a dull note on percussion. But if the swelling is retroperitoneal or deeply located, coils of intestines may overlie the swelling and a resonant note may be obtained, as in case of a renal lump. If the swelling is in the upper abdomen, note whether the dullness over the lump is continuous with the liver dullness and splenic dullness. Percuss for the upper border of liver, then the lower border, and note the liver span. Confirm the mobility of the diaphragm by tidal percussion. Then percuss for spleen in the left 9th intercostal space from the posterior axillary line forwards. If spleen is enlarged, the dullness will extend beyond the mid-axillary line. If a renal lump is suspected, percuss posteriorly in the loin, just lateral to the erector spinae. Normally, this area is resonant due to the presence of the colon. If the kidney is enlarged, the note will become dull. But in other lumps like spleen, it remains resonant. Then percuss from the umbilicus to the flanks for detecting ascitic fluid. If there is dullness in the flanks, try to demonstrate shifting dullness. Keep the plexometer finger just lateral to the border of dullness and roll the patient over to the opposite side. Wait for 20 seconds and percuss again. If the note has become resonant, then presence of free fluid in the abdomen is confirmed. Then turn the patient supine again and demonstrate that the note is dull once again. If the dullness extends to both flanks and suprapubic regions as seen in this case, it is termed as horseshoe-shaped dullness. If there is a large ascites or a large cystic lump, percuss for fluid thrill. For fluid thrill, ask an assistant to press the ulnar border of his hand vertically over the center of the swelling. Keep your left hand gently over one side of the swelling and tap the opposite side with the right hand. If the swelling contains fluid under tension, the palpating hand will feel a thrust after a small delay or time gap following the tap. This is termed as fluid thrill. Observe in slow motion the percussion wave traveling across the abdomen to the palpating finger. This is the fluid thrill. If the swelling is suspected to be a hydated cyst, try to elicit hydated thrill or the after thrill. Place three fingers of the left hand spread out over the swelling and percuss gently over the middle one. A peculiar quivering sensation or after thrill will be felt by the lateral fingers due to the displaced daughter cysts hitting the wall of the swelling. After percussion, auscultate carefully over the abdomen for abnormal sounds and peristalsis. If the lump is pulsatile, auscultate over it first for a bruit. Auscultate over the abdominal aorta and then over the renal arteries for bruit. If the liver or spleen is enlarged, auscultate over them for hepatic rub and splenic rub during deep inspiration. Auscultate in the periumbilical area and the right iliac fossa for peristalsis. Tinkling sounds will indicate intestinal obstruction. Lastly, always perform the per-rectal examination and in female patients a per-vaginal examination. This completes the clinical examination of a case of intra-abdominal lump.